tracked and published. People need to be held accountable. Headcount should be evaluated to the needs of the business and budget. You walk into a hospital today and you see customer satisfaction ratings all over the hospital. That can be done here as well. Human resources needs to do with human resources, dozen corporations. I don't think that's what human resources does here in the capital of Tibet. One area is equal opportunity to jobs by hiring the best candidate, not the most connected Republican. Mr. Supervisor, this is a big challenge for you. You certainly seem to have the enthusiasm to do it. Again, the ball is in your team's court. You can't accomplish this alone. I'm just going to end that with the big thing in my mind with ethics right now is, and I want to point out, I have got a bunch of foils in that are unanswered and not responded to over the past few weeks and some prior. But the big one right now that is overdue is the foil about Cashin, Spinelli, and Ferretti in regards to Mr. Spinelli's wife, who works here at the Town of Oyster Bay in Human Resources. And I clearly, in a prior meeting, read the town code, and Mrs. Spinelli should have put on record a disclosure on file because her husband has a company that significantly benefits the town of Oyster Bay. And that foil was put in on January 11th. And I was told that the information is forthcoming. And the town of Oyster Bay needed 20 days. Well, I think it's over 10 days overdue, and I would appreciate. And that's the only one I'm going to read right now, because I'm going to give you time to digest, but you'll certainly be hearing about more, especially if they go answered. And in closing, I would suggest that you get a list of the unanswered and unresponded to FOILs from the town clerk's office, so that you can see for yourself how the appearance is given that you have something to hide.
So we can see what's going on. Thank you.
See what's going on.
Thank you for your testimony. Thank you. Just on that note, we will be looking at all those requests, and I asked the deputy supervisor to go over with me Mr. McKenna's emails so that we can get them answered and that we can provide information. You know, when I say it's a new day in the town of Oyster Bay, those are not just words. And if you don't believe me, watch me.
We're watching.
Thank you. Thank you. Our next speaker is Leslie Levy of Syosset. Hi, how are you today?
Hi, I'm Leslie Levy of residents from our beautiful Syosset.
I'm Laura Schultz. I'm president of residents from our beautiful Syosset.
We speak with Bud.
We speak with two voices,
but two different microphone heights, so bear with me.
So it's Leslie Levy, and your name, please?
Laura Schultz.
And we would like to congratulate and welcome our new supervisor,
Deputy Supervisor,
the other people who are sworn in today. And we are inviting the supervisor, when the weather gets nicer, to come see beautiful downtown Syosset, tour it with us, and see what we will be bringing to your attention and asking you about.
I'd love to.
On a personal note, I thank you for your promise of more transparency. As you've seen, it's not just one or two people who want it. That's what we get from our membership, that everybody wants. We are, however, non-political. We are observers, however, and Laura, our president, has been observing for 15 years, which is, you know, a long time, longer time in the audience than some of the protagonists.
I've been sitting in the back since 2002.
There you go. And we were here when the new ethics regulations were passed, with about three lines on the agenda, but about seven pages, and we appreciate them, and thank you.
Laura's been sitting back there as long as I've been sitting here, and she's
we'll give this new supervisor some history, okay? So in 2002, Leslie and I were appointed to the Syosset Hamlet Committee for the redevelopment and revitalization of downtown Syosset. Councilman Cusignano was our chairperson when we served there for 4 years.
Co-chairperson.
Co-chairperson. Okay, then I guess.
Councilwoman Eisenberg.
Okay, so we were 20 people, business owners and residents who volunteered countless hours.
Very, very active.
To try to help.
Extremely active.
Our downtown. Residence was founded before that in 1999. We're a beautification civic group. We were founded for three principles: beautification of downtown Syosset, pedestrian and vehicular safety, and railroad safety, and redevelopment of the downtown. So you have a core group of people that love Syosset, and we have people, other people have done different things in the schools, but we have focused primarily on that downtown and that railroad situation. So we have been active with the MTA and have gone to numerous meetings looking at the train station there, because we all live very close to the train station within walking distance, which is why we bought our houses there. But what's happened is with more and more trains, the parking situation is difficult, to say the least, and
it's
outrageous.
It's nothing short of atrocious.
I know.
I'm looking at several people sitting in the audience that it affects, and it affects everyone.
I know, and Councilman Chris has been very helpful in trying to mitigate that. All right, what we are
more helpful.
Well, what we are waiting on is the New York State Legislature, and if they pass accommodation for Uber and Lyft throughout the state, that could possibly change our whole situation, because a lot of people would be willing to use Uber to get to the train station. So parking actually may not be an issue if that transpires, and we'll see how that all works. But we would like to invite you to downtown Syosset to do a walkthrough, and I make the best brownies in Syosset, so we'll give you some on the way.
Before the ladies go, I think they've been very modest, because I know they don't want to hit you with everything at once today, but there's an outstanding grant that's been kicking around for a few years.
A state grant?
Yes.
The state through the Department of Transportation and the federal government. The committee that worked on it, Laura and Leslie, were no small part of it. They actually championed the cause with a few other people. They wrote a grant proposal at the time and asked for, with the town's assistance, $1.6 million in the grant program. And I think there were 50 or 60 grants that went through the state process, and the Syosset grant request finished number 9. And when they asked for $1.6 million, they were hoping to get a fraction of that. And in the end, the state, with the town's assistance, awarded the whole $1.6 million because they felt it warranted for the downtown in Syosset. Work was done south of the railroad tracks. Work has not commenced north of the tracks. And in a nutshell, that $1.6 million still sits there for, I believe, now 7 years. Uh-huh. So I know it would be at the top of your wish list. I don't know if I'm going to live to see it. I hope we all live to see it. But it's out there, and you should know of it. Perhaps with these ladies' wonderful help, we can finally see it.
Well, yeah, we have spoken to Matt Russo and also Colin Bell regarding it over the past week. So that would be the fruition of everything.
That's a biggie that's sitting there that can be done.
Great news. Thank you. I'll circle back with them so that I get a briefing on what's going on. And I thank you for the opportunity to not only come to see Syosset, because I've been there many times, but to see it through your eyes. That's what makes the difference.
Our members' eyes,
really. Yes. And we have 300 members that support us financially so we can stay in business. And what we have done in the past is we will bring their concerns to you at these meetings, right? Because they are not, although they are going to have night meetings, so they might be able to come. But we take a lot of input. Not now in the winter, everything's dormant, but as soon as spring comes and the potholes are there and everything, so we will bring that stuff to you at these meetings.
Thank you. Looking forward to meeting with you. Thanks for being here today. So if there are no other speakers.
I have put in a question.
Oh, okay.
to the podium.
Robert Greb, please join us at the podium.
Hello again, Mr. Interim Supervisor and Town Board. I mentioned a little bit earlier the New York State Law Section 125, Paragraph 2, which directs the supervisor to provide a financial statement to the Town Board at the end of each month, and which should include a detailed statement of all money received and dispersed for that month. And this document is supposed to be on file with the clerk's office. And I just wanted to let you know that I requested that back in January 3rd, and I've got no response at all. And I'd like to know, have you been receiving this document all along, council people, prior to the interim supervisor's appointment? Have you been receiving a monthly statement from our former indicted supervisor, Mr. Mendetta?
We're here to listen to your testimony, to address the issues, and to get to this, because I certainly will be looking into that.
Okay.
So please continue to use your time.
I'd just like to take an opportunity. I thought Tim Zike might be here today. Myself, Mr. Casciano, Mr. Zike, were working on some various discrepancies with properties, and we had spoke about Joe Mark Court, and Mr. Zike was holding off until I submitted a formal request for investigation, so I'd like to do that right now. And also, I've been having a problem with my FOIL request. I'm trying to get, Andrew Milkenny has a consulting contract with the town, and he should be filling out one of these Town of Oyster Bay claim forms. This is Linda Mondello's, one of her forms. And I've been FOILing this, and I keep getting these responses that my information's already been provided. But the fact of the matter is, I've never seen or gotten a copy of any copy of this document from Mr. Andrew Milkenny, so I'd like to turn in this FOIL request again. Hopefully you can give me that. And listen, you know, I'm very appreciative for your claims of the action that you intend to take. But I'm also very concerned because it seems that nobody ever answers any of the residents' questions. As a matter of fact, I'm very distressed because none of the board members ever answer my emails besides the occasional secretary that responds that it was received. Nobody interacts with me. Nobody returns my phone calls. I've called Councilwoman Alicia three times since the last meeting, her office. She hasn't returned my phone calls. I don't think it's fair. You know. Listen, you're going to make your own bed like everybody else in the world, okay? I come up here and I say, I'd like to know why this guy, Jeffrey Lesser, was hired in the manner that he was. Why is it so secretive? Why are the official records altered? Why are the videos altered of it? No answer. No answer. We're going to answer you later. I questioned the change in the town codes to no videotaping. Okay? Let me ask you a question. I hope some of you watched the videotape of Mr. Altadonna accosting me after the last meeting over here. I specifically asked him to leave me alone, but this is the gentleman that we're supposed to believe that is so petrified of me that he's up here complaining that I'm a bigot against Italians and he can't be in the same room with me, but yet he's going out of his way to attack me after a meeting. Why wouldn't a resident want to videotape everything that goes on? Why, when I come up with a FOIL request, why am I directed into a secretive side room? This is ridiculous. Of course I want to videotape everything to protect myself from behavior like this. First of all, in that incident, I know the rest of the town people know about it, and to be fair with everyone, I'm not going to rehash it here, but what I'd like to say is, I hope that you're being honest, and I hope that you will respond to my emails, and we will discuss what's going on. Because, listen, let's face it, John Vendetto was arrested. So I don't blame him for not answering my questions up here, because he's a criminal, okay? Now you're getting a new chance, just like everybody else. And I just would like to get some answers to what's going on here in the town of Oyster Bay. We tabled a resolution to pay $11,800 to Foley Griffin. Was that for Mendetto's defense? What's it for? Something back in October of the preceding year. I've been emailing everybody. I've addressed it two or three times in a town meeting. I constantly get promised, we'll answer that later. Listen, Bill's Towing, you tabled their resolution. They're occupying and operating this lot for this ridiculous rent at 150 Sios Place since June with no lease or anything. Right? Landtech, it's got like a $1,200 a month lease in Bethpage in the dump over there. You don't want to talk about that, all right? Like I say, you know, I, I'm Quite frankly, I'm disgusted with the town board, right? Not you, sir, because you just started. I don't know you from Adam. And I'm hoping that you prove to me that I'm wrong. Okay, so thank you for your service. It's nice to meet you. You know, we live in the same neighborhood. And, you know, I just want to turn those things in. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your testimony. Mr. Robert Fryer from Woodbury. Good afternoon now.
Good afternoon. First of all, congratulations on your appointment.
Thank you.
I just want to make a couple of comments. I appreciate your several comments about transparency. However, in my personal opinion, you haven't shown that today yet so far in not answering questions that were asked specifically on resolutions. When you announced and swore in your new deputy supervisor, you gave his whole background, but you neglected to say that he's also been the treasurer of your campaign for a long time, and he's also the son of a former Town of Oyster Bay board member. So to me, that's not being transparent. I would hope you will also consider taking, you know, and you also voted on questionable resolutions to contractors that, shall we say, are politically connected within the town. And I appreciate you mentioning that you've been interviewing the ethics board people this past week. And I would love for you to commit that that you're not going to have just Republicans and Democratic Party members, but independent people who are not affiliated with any party, members of the Women's Equality Party, and not just members of the Independence Party, which is sort of another another extension of the Republican Party. I'd also love to know an update on the federal housing discrimination case and how much we've spent to date now, not year to date, but to date on the outside council. We read about a new investigation that's going on in the town, within the town. A grand jury's been impaneled. I'd like to, if you would comment on that investigation and the status of it, and how, again, and what kind of outside counsel is being used for that. There was also an article recently in the newspaper about the town misused finances to pay back, borrowed bond money, used it from the general fund for a fund that's used to pay operating expenses, and apparently that was used to pay back these bonds, which is illegal. Rob D'Arienzo was quoted in the paper saying he knows it's illegal. He's in charge of finance. If he knows it's illegal and he did it, why is he still working here? And then just some other comments I wanted to bring up. I hope you'll look at the rampant nepotism within this town and the jobs that are handed out to family members that work here. For example, also, I would hope you'll, I don't know if you're taking the town up on its, I know the past supervisor got a car. I'd like to know if you're getting a new car, or you're going to take the indicted supervisor's former car, or not take a car. Going back on Mr. Carman, I'd like to understand who else was interviewed. I'd like to understand that Mr. Councilman Muscarella, did he resign, or was he asked to resign as deputy supervisor? And then back on the Cerro Wire, the town, I believe, got $30 million for that piece of land. Is the town paying school taxes on that property today, or is the Syosset school missing out on that school tax revenue? I think that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Oh, actually, one last thing. I hope you'll, since you were appointed, and I'm assuming, and you've already announced your candidacy for November, that you'll hold off and maybe even reconsider putting signs with your name on them all across the town as the former supervisor did.
Thanks for your testimony. Quite a few questions there, but it is, as I said, a time of transparency for this town. I'm going to address one or two of them without getting into a long discussion on this, because we'll be adhering to the rules of transparency and accepting any and all suggestions from people who want to act in a statesmanlike manner to provide information to our town. But it does give me an opportunity to mention the car. You pointed out this is just one of many ways in which we'll be doing business differently. I, as your town supervisor, will be using my own personal car. I, as your town supervisor, will be using my own phone, not a town phone. I, as your town supervisor, and I want to commend my colleagues on the town board. Under our contract, our town employees are giving back a portion of their salaries. The elected officials are doing the same to show the right leadership. I, too, am giving back a portion of my salary because it is the right message to send to our taxpayers, to our employees, and to everyone involved. And as the first employee of this town, post-contract, I'll be paying into my health insurance. Now, as someone who has gone in the legislature, has worked in the legislature, and put my work before money, put my commitment and responsibility before anything else, I get it. And I understand why the public has these questions. And we will be acting in an appropriate and lawful manner, and we'll be letting you know of what we're doing and why we're doing it throughout the process. So I appreciate the testimony of the public, appreciate the questions and the inquiries. We'll be looking in to make sure that the issues raised today are addressed and that we're fully vetted on these items. Is there anyone else who would like to make a public comment today? Board members?
Supervisor, can I just make one more statement?
Sure, Mr. McKenna, if you make a brief one. It's bending the rules. You're asking me to bend the rules. You're asking me not to bend the rules in the town. And then you're asking me to bend them all in the same meeting. But come on up.
You know, we've been told, and we're kind of told again today, that public session is not a question and answer period, okay? Which I understand. But, again, we send emails to the board, and aside from some confirmations, we don't get any answers. So, questions have come up today. There's many others. In order for you to move forward in these meetings where we come up and we're talking about positive, but we need to get past the stuff. Otherwise, next week, I haven't brought up, you know, I was easy, and I'm sure others, you know, and I'm a lightweight here. So how do you intend to put these answers to the question, when and how is that going to be done? So that you can move forward without the baggage of the past. How are you going to do that?
Thank you. It's only right to address a question that I'm sure everyone in the public has. In terms of questions, I think it's most appropriate to run these things through staff so we get the best updated and most accurate information out to the residents. I was informed that there is already a policy in place here in the town, the rules of decorum of the town board, which we will observe and embrace. But in terms of the way we're dealing with public comment, testimony brought to us, I've been involved in state government for almost 14 years, been a part of hearings, as a member of the Ways and Means Committee, the conference committees, the budget committees, even the mothership that perhaps you watch on television. This is the way we've conducted business in an ethical, and a manner that brings the best information to us in a statesmanlike manner. And if it's good enough for the state capitol, it's good enough for the town of Oyster Bay. Like a motion to end the meeting, if there's no other business. Thank you, everyone. We look forward to seeing you at our next meeting.